Hey everybody, this is Real Deal Sports Talk with KP. It's May 31st, 2018. Can you get down to this?
D-Town, can you vibe to this? A D-Town getting down to this. Can you get down to this? The party's rocking and the crowd was lit. The beat's knocking in the sound system. And D-Town's in here. We hit the lick to get some crown to sip. The pip is hitting like a pound of bricks. Took a powerful rip. It felt like a time traveling trip. My mind drifting to the cloudy abyss. Till my chalice is sip. Chicks admire how I'm styling my fit. I acknowledge with the smile of a prince. Can tell I'm piling my chips. The party's rocking. Everybody was bent. Nobody wilding. Ain't no violence in here. We all lounging for real. The smooth sounds got us vibing and shit. In D-Town, steady vibing to this. Can you get down to this? The party's rocking and the crowd was lit. The beat's knocking and the sound.
Hey, everybody. Welcome in. This is Real Deal Sports Talk with KP. It is May 31st, 2018. How is everybody doing on this Thursday night? Are you ready for the finals? Are you excited for the NHL Finals and what's been going on there? Have you been following some of the drama out there in the sports world? Hopefully your work week is wrapping up nicely. Mine is progressing, you know. As many of you know, during the week, I work for Denver Public Schools. I'm a school technology partner. I partner with these different schools, three schools this year, and help them take care of their technology, learn about their technology, make their financial plans for their technology, purchase things, fix things. Pretty much, you know, I partner with the school on their technology. So it's that time of year. Teachers are checking out. The kids are going home. Things can be a little hectic, a little stressful, a lot to get done. You got to dot your I's, cross your T's, make sure everything's taken care of the right way. So my week's progressing. Hopefully your week's going good. We got the NBA Finals. They are kicking off here in just under 2 hours. We're definitely going to be talking about that tonight. We'll catch up on the NHL Finals. Major coaching news today, as a coach who just won his third straight title is leaving his club. We got stories coming out of the NBA about a GM out on the creep, you know, maybe doing some shady stuff. We'll talk about that a little bit. We'll see what we can get to. There's all kinds of stuff going on out there. That track you heard at the beginning of the show, that was The Barbarians, Don Banks and Vivid Scientific here out of Denver, Colorado. You can check them out through our webpage. You go to the webpage, realdealsportstalkwithkp.com. Go ahead, click over on Check Us Out. And from there, you can see the Barbarians section. Hit them up on their SoundCloud, see what else they got going on. Check them out on Facebook if you want. They're real cool guys. I've known them for a long time and proud of what they're doing there. The Barbarians, real lyricism. Also on the page, if you know you haven't visited the page, you can reach out to us always. There's the text line, 720-515-5597. Our email address is up there, all the links to our social media. You're going to find some new stuff there for the Idaho Phoenix on the Check Us Out page. You'll find some new stuff for Vance Johnson, Vance Inspires there, link to Future of Palm Beach if you need a helpline, access to his YouTube and Facebook pages. We added that information up on the homepage. You're going to notice that we have information up for the Circle of Stars football and cheerleading camp coming up June 30th. Myself, I will be up there covering the camp. Hopefully I'll be able to get some interviews with some of these guys that I can share with you on air. But that is June 30th in Fort Collins at Fort Collins High School. It's the second annual Circle of Stars football camp, and this year they are adding in the cheerleading camp. They have all kinds of coaches, former college players. Vance Joseph of the Broncos is involved. Go to the website, circleofstarsacademy.com. You can sign up there, sign up earlier than later, or you can reach out to Eric Anderson. His phone number is on the website. Check it out there. Colorado Crush and Denver Broncos cheerleaders are going to be involved. It's going to be great for the kids. And everybody who registers by May 31st will receive a special autograph action shot by one of the camp staff. So a lot of these guys are names, either through their time in the NFL, their time in college football, their time being a professional cheerleader. So check that out. That's great. I'm glad to partner with them. That's huge for us at Real Deal Sports Talk with KP. So yeah, definitely check out the website. A lot going on over there. Links to all of our friends of the show. Marcus Ogden's links are on there. The real estate doctor, Chad Nash, of Remax Alliance is on there. The Barbarians, Idaho Phoenix, all of our social media is on there. So check out the website, realdealsportstalkwithkp.com. All right, that was a long enough intro. Let's be done with the intro stuff, all right? I'll run some commercials starting Monday, and we'll have that kind of information put into those. Let's get into sports. NBA Finals. Like I said, the game's kicking off here in just under 2 hours. I'm definitely tuning in. You should be tuning in. We'll get to all the information about it being the fourth year in a row with the same teams, blah, blah, blah. First, let's start off with the Celtics and the Rockets. And no, they're not playing in the finals, but should they be? I mean, come now. Come on now. Shouldn't this be the Celtics and the Rockets? The Celtics had the series wrapped up. They had shown the Cavaliers and everybody else they were the better team. They let it get to a game seven. They let LeBron get in their head. And then they went ahead and they fell in love with the three-pointer. Both of these teams fell in love with the three-pointer. And it ruined them. I mean, Aaron Bynes, he disappeared late in the series. Had a decent presence in the first couple of games, but disappeared late in the series. Jaylen Brown, great series. You can see he's going to be a star. Al Horford was inconsistent. Marcus Morris started the series well, disappeared at the end. Marcus Smart, he's talking about he might want to leave now. Reports are $14, $15, $16 million per. He was the most consistent player they had. Terry Rozier, he had a nice end of the season for a guy who has spent most of his career not on an active roster. Jason Tatum, young stud. And they didn't have Kyrie. They didn't have Gordon Hayward. But they showed with those guys, with Tatum, with Morris, with Horford, with Rozier, with Smart, with Brown, with Baines, that they were the better team. They were better than Cleveland. They were tougher. They had more hustle. They had a chip on their shoulder. But by game seven, they let LeBron take that chip, dip the chip, and eat the chip. It was all but decided when they showed up to the arena how that game was going to go. The Rockets, this is a team, they don't shoot intermediate shots. It's layups or threes for them. Which, I don't like that brand of basketball. It might grow on me, but I'm sick of watching shots go up and nobody's there to try and rebound. Everybody's just running back on defense. Trevor Ariza did not have a good series. Clint Capella, he's a verging star. I really like that guy. I think that's why you hear these rumors about the Celtics maybe being interested in Mo Bamba. He's a similar type player. Eric Gordon, great coming off the bench situationally, three-point shooter, high percentage there, 46%, I think. Not enough out of him from this series. Gerald Green, the often-traveled. James Harden did not have a good series again. Good game one. Joe Johnson, he's just another guy on the team. He got some play. Chris Paul getting hurt was probably the worst thing that could have happened to the Rockets. They quite possibly, even with all the other junk, missing 27 three-pointers in a row, which wouldn't have happened if Chris Paul was running the point, they more than likely go ahead and move on to the finals and beat Golden State if Chris Paul doesn't get hurt. Because he missed the last two games of the series. He gets hurt game five, sits out game six. We're hoping game seven. He misses two games. Houston's out. That defensive presence, that veteran calm, that person who could come out on the court, get everybody where they needed to be, run the offense, make his own shot. I mean, they lost that. And they went back to the team they were last year, and they found their way out of the playoffs. Both of them had home court. The Rockets were the number one seed. The Celtics were the... Or no. Yeah, the Celtics were the two seed. The Rockets missed 27 straight three-pointers. Most all time. You live and die by that three, and they both of these teams did. If I had to pick one and say the other one was worse, I would have to say that it was probably worse that the Rockets lost. They probably had it worse. Because nobody believed in the Celtics outside of the Celtics anyway. We had all written the East off. All the reports had written the East off to LeBron before the playoffs started. And some of the crazy stuff that's coming out of these playoffs and stats and facts and things like that. Outside of we've learned that the Celtics are in position to be a very good team and they have some young talent that is going to be really good. We're fourth straight. Right, four straight years. Well, on top of that, ESPN stats, the Cavaliers have faced the Pacers, Raptors, Celtics, and Warriors in that order for the second straight year. And according to Elias Sports, the last teams to play the same teams in the same order in consecutive postseasons were the 72-73 Knicks back when there were only three rounds. So the Cavaliers have faced the four teams in the same order for two straight years. That just doesn't happen. So everybody wants to complain about, oh, I'm sick of seeing these teams in the finals. It's not just that. It's the same matchups in the playoffs. It's the same defeats in the playoffs so far. And now there's never been a team who's been a bigger underdog in the finals than Cleveland is this year to Golden State. With LeBron making it to the finals this year, 19 out of the last 20 years, the NBA Finals have had Tim Duncan, Kobe Bryant, or LeBron James in. 19 out of the last 20 years. And if you throw in Dwayne Wade, and you might as well throw Shaq in, it's 20 out of 20 because Shaq was on some of those teams. Shaq was on the 2006 team with Dwayne Wade that won it. Shaq was on the 2000 team with Kobe Bryant that won it. 2001, 2002. So you can throw those two names in there. So that goes to part of the reason why NBA fans are getting to this position. It's not just that LeBron is going otherworldly and has made it to eight straight finals. Yes, albeit out of a weaker conference than the Western Conference. Yes, it has switched who's the power, the East and the West, since Jordan played, and the East was so strong. But 20 years represented all every year one of four players, and 19 out of 20 years one of three players. That goes as much to what's going on in the NBA as anything. The teams that have the star power or the best player or the best coaching are the ones that are making it. And the other clubs just go through regular season selling tickets, merchandise, and making money. And they clearly do not have a real shot in the NBA. And again, this is LeBron's eighth straight NBA Finals. Yes, he's 3-5. But to go with that 3-5 record, guess what? His teams have only been favored in two of the now nine finals he's made it to. So when everybody wants to throw out these stats, who's better? Who's the greatest of all time? There's as many stats in favor of Jordan and LeBron as there are against each other, okay? Throw Kobe in there. You know the name that everybody tends to forget and doesn't want to mention about the greatest of all time? Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Like, his accomplishments, for whatever reason, are very overlooked. His longevity in the game. His hook shot that was unstoppable. his defense, the championships he won. So just appreciate greatness, okay? Let's stop the debate about who's better. Stop hating on people and appreciate greatness when you see it. Because that's what we have in LeBron James. You look at the Cavs, Warriors, fourth straight year. You look at the Cavs roster. What do the Cavs need for this to be a successful finals? Well, they need a lot. Rodney Hood's fallen out of favor. I thought he would be a defender, create your own shot, maybe sixth, seventh man type guy for this team, be able to run the offense a little bit when LeBron needed rest. That didn't happen. They need George Hill to stay aggressive. He can't just be aggressive in Cleveland. He needs to have that same aggression in Golden State each and every game. Jeff Green, they're going to need him to be tough. He's going to have to be tough. He's going to have to hit shots when he gets them. Kyle Korver is going to have to shoot 40 to 50% from the three-point line. Kevin Love's going to have to shoot 30 to 45% from the three-point line. Stay healthy. Larry Nance is going to have to provide that hustle, those defensive rebounds, those offensive rebounds, some putbacks here and there. LeBron's going to have to be otherworldly. J.R. Smith, we need you. You're going to have to get 10 to 15 points at least four times. Tristan Thompson, just rebound. Just get rebounds, hustle plays, lock down your guy on defense. If the Cavs can get all of that, which they haven't out of this squad yet, they have a chance. They really do, because they have LeBron James. Now you look at the Warriors team. Oh, well, what do the Warriors have to do to win? They pretty much need to show up. They're a good defensive team. They have three of the top shooters, if not the three top shooters, in the NBA right now, in Klay Thompson, Steph Curry, and Kevin Durant. Okay, Cook is good off the bench. Jordan Bell is finding his way on this roster. Iguodala, he's out for game one, but he will be back, and, you know, everybody wants to coin him the LeBron stopper. Okay, that's fine. They've got good backups. Sean Livingston, Draymond Green, great starter. You have the veteran in David West, who you have Nick Young, who can put up threes. I mean, this team is built to play a fast, upbeat, athletic, defensive style. You really have to like the way this team is put together. They have length. They have athleticism. They have a guy like Zaza who could come in and give you that bigger-bodied guy, if need be, and he's clearly willing to foul people. JaVale McGee can come out and give you some minutes and some blocks, some magical putback dunks here and there. This is a solid roster. They're going to be really hard to beat. The guys they continue to add into the roster, like a Jordan Bell, okay, a 6'9 guy who can play center, who can play forward, like a Quinn Cook who's come around and starting to get more minutes, like a Patrick McCaw, who's a good fill-in guy throughout the regular season, hasn't played so much in the postseason, but gave him good minutes throughout the regular season. Bringing these guys along, giving them time, giving them their minutes here and there, is just making them better on this team that continues to win. Four straight finals appearance. If they win this year, they have won three of the last four finals. The only teams in the other sports to meet in three consecutive championships. Three, not four, but three consecutive championships. Because Golden State and Cleveland have now done it four straight years in the NBA. In the NHL, you have the Montreal Canadiens and Detroit Red Wings. They met three straight years from 1954 to 1956. One pride, my Detroit Lions faced the Cleveland Browns from 52 to 54 in what was then the NFL championship. And in baseball, the New York Giants, later became the San Francisco Giants, took on the New York Yankees from 1921 to 1923. Only occurrences in the other sports. Now, what would a loss mean for these two teams? Well, for Golden State, it would be a huge letdown. Let's face it. They're the better team. they're something like 1,000-1 favorite over Cleveland, something ridiculous. So it would be huge for them to lose this final. But in the long run, for the team, for the players, is it going to hurt their legacy? No, they've still won 2 out of the last 4. They've still been to 4 in a row. They're still the most dominant team currently in the NBA all around, defensively, offensively. You don't want to face them when they're hot, when all 3 of their marksmen, their snipers, are going strong. So it doesn't mean that much for them. Huge story. Devastating. But in the long run, we're still great. Now, on the other side, what does it mean for Cleveland? Well, for a lot of the guys, you know, not that much. But you hear these stories and reports, Rob Parker out there, among others, saying if LeBron loses, he'll never be the greatest of all time, or he is at that point unable to catch Michael Jordan. Just won't do it, can't do it, it's over, story's done. I go back to his teams have only been favored 2 out of 9 appearances. Now, one of those times they were favored, they lost to the Dallas Mavericks. They should have won that series. They didn't. They showed up. They didn't play to the best of their ability, and they found a team that was not scared of the big three and took it to them, and rightfully so. Everybody's favorite go-to guy, Jordan, his teams were favored every single time. And it wasn't just because he was on the team. Okay, if that's how it worked, if the best player in the league makes it to the finals and his team's favored, then LeBron's team would have been favored 9 times so far, not 6 for Jordan. Okay, let's just, I'm saying, there's stats out there that either one of these guys could be the greatest of all time, depending on how you look at it. And I'll go back on record. I think the greatest player of all time was Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Said it on this show before. I also have said it on this show before. I do think LeBron is a better player overall than Michael Jordan. Okay? That being said, for LeBron, to me, does this hurt his legacy? No, because he's already 5 deep in the loss column. What makes his, what the part of this that gets his legacy going is that he got this team, this group of role players, to this final. That he got this team that was put together at the trade deadline mostly to the finals. That he got this team without Kyrie Irving to the finals. That he got this team with Kevin Love having most recently the concussion, but dealing with his mental illness that he was brave enough to step forward with, and other injuries, that he got this team to the NBA Finals. He got this team. If you haven't been reading all the stats out there, there's so many stats. Everybody finds stats. Everybody finds occurrences and trends and these kind of things. But one that really caught my eye, because there's so many out there right now about, well, the last time, what was the world like when LeBron last didn't make the finals? This one, this stat that I think Sports Nation put out, 78% of current NBA players had not yet made their debut when LeBron James last missed the NBA Finals. 78% of the league had not played their first game yet. The last time this man did not take his team through the Eastern Conference to the finals. Are you kidding me? More than 3/4 of the league had not played their first game the last time LeBron did not make it to the finals. And he's got role players. So who comes and steps up for LeBron's role players as everybody's been making these comments? Of course, Steph Curry of the Golden State Warriors. He says, respect these players. Leave them alone. Shannon Sharp comes back and on his show, FS1, with Skip Bayless, First Take. And he talks about how Steph won the unanimous MVP, won 73 games. And then went out and recruited Kevin Durant. Had already won a championship. And went out and recruited Kevin Durant to the team. So Shannon's point basically is, Steph doesn't have a leg to stand on about talking about other people's role players not being good enough when he went out and recruited the second best player in the game to come to his team. And you somewhat got a point there. You hear guys like Scottie Pippen making comments. And everybody's got their side to it. But the fact of the matter is, in the NBA, there's certain teams that make it to the finals. And everybody else is going through the motions. 19 out of 20 seasons, Duncan, Bryant, or James. 4 straight years, the same 2 teams. 2 straight years, Cleveland has faced the same 4 teams in order in the postseason. I'm excited. We got an hour and a half now until tip-off. Everybody should check it out. If you don't know, the game is on. Let me see. What is it on ESPN? Is it on ABC? Let's see. The game is on. What channel that game on tonight? ABC. That's what I thought. I think the whole series is on ABC. So as many people can watch it as possible. Please tune in. It's going to be good basketball. Hopefully. Hopefully it's not like the Eastern Conference Finals were. It was almost unwatchable at times. With the way guys would shoot, there'd be nobody there. You just go back the other way, shoot, go back. It was missing defense. I thought the last few games lacked a lot of hustle and want and desire outside of LeBron willing Cleveland through. So tune in. Game 1, NBA Finals tonight. Other finals going on. Oh my goodness, the NHL Finals, the Las Vegas Golden Knights, baby, and the Washington Capitals. Vegas goes out, they win the first game 6-4 in an amazing offensive hockey game. And the Vegas Knights, again, I love their Twitter. The score of tonight's Golden Knights win by the Stanley Cup final 6-4. Not a video game. Because, in hockey video games, you can get that a lot. But it was a great offensive performance. Capitals, they come out and win game 2. And that, with them winning game 2, ESPN Stats and Info says that that's just the 3rd Stanley Cup final since 2005. So in the last 13 years, to be tied 1-1. That doesn't happen very much. It's normally 2-0. So that's kind of cool. Now the series shifts back to Washington, where now the Capitals are going to be on home ice with their first ever Stanley Cup win under their belt. They're 0-5 entering tonight, which I'm not quite sure how they're 0-5, but I got these numbers from ESPN Stats. So they have 0-5, because the first game of the series, duh. When you just talk stuff out sometimes, then your brain kicks on. So they're 0-5. Entering game 2, and they win that one. So now as they go back to Washington, they have that first win in the Stanley Cup Finals under the belt. Ovechkin has that first taste of Stanley Cup victory. It's going to be real interesting to see what turn this series takes while they're in Washington. Because it could be a situation where the Golden Knights pick up a game, pick up 2 games. Or it could be a situation where you see a team like the Capitals all of a sudden go up 3-1. Put Golden Knights in that tough position. We'll have to see. The last 6 teams to win game 1 of the Stanley Cup final, however, have gone on to then win the Stanley Cup. So the Golden Knights have that on their magical run side. The last team to win game 1 but not win the series was the 2011 Canucks. They lost to the Bruins that year. So, as you know, casual fan, but still, this is intriguing to me. I would bet this is very intriguing to a lot of NHL fans, a lot of Vegas fans. I mean, you look at the production they're putting on there in Vegas. They're proud of their team. They're trying to make money on that team. The fans are showing up for the team. Washington Capitals, they've been one of the better teams for years now, and they're finally getting their chance. They've gotten over their hump in the East. I mean, tune in, watch. It's good stuff. It's going to lead to a first-time champion. Whoever wins the Stanley Cup will be their first time winning a championship. One, a little more Disney magical story, the Las Vegas Golden Knights. But the other one, just as good of a story with one of the game, if not the game's best player. Now over on the pitch, over in Europe, on the football field, big news today, Zinedine Zidane has left his role as the Real Madrid head coach. Now, this is surprising to me. Everybody who watched football or watched the UEFA championships this past weekend saw a great game between Real Madrid and Liverpool for the championship. This was a game that was, it was 0-0 at the half. Real Madrid won 3-1. Zinedine Zidane has coached this team to 3 straight titles, a total of 9 trophies in just 3 years, 878 days as coach. Second most successful coach in team history. Now, I haven't seen anything, I haven't heard anything as to why, if he's got other opportunities, if he's going to do something else. But when I first heard the name, I connected it, and I was like, oh, wait, that's the guy. That's the guy who headbutted the guy in the World Cup playing for France and got kicked out of the game. That's where I knew him from. So then I started researching him and the team because I had watched the game this weekend. It was on during my barbecue on Saturday. I was shocked that right after halftime, it was 1-1, 2-1, which like seemed so fast. It was probably in the first 15 or 20 minutes. But, you know, you're running around at a barbecue. So when the whole first half was played so tight and the one scoring opportunity was called back because the guy was offsides just barely. But it was a great game. So they win. You hear the rumors of Ronaldo might be leaving. And then the coach, just a few days later, he decides to leave his role. So it makes you wonder, what's going on there with the Real Madrid club? Is there something with ownership? Is there some, you know, what is going on that your best player is rumored or reported as to possibly thinking of leaving, and then the coach who's helped you win 9 trophies over less than 900 days and 3 UEFA championships is gone? It was historic, really. I mean, they're the first team since themselves to have reached and won that many championships in a row. The first time they did it, they did 5 Euro Cup finals between 56 and 1960. And there's only ever been 5 other clubs to have even reached 3 in a row. So they've now done 3 in a row and 5 in a row. The other teams were Benfica, Ajax, Bayern, and AC Milan, and also Juventus in the Championships Leagues era. Now, there's all kinds of soccer teams throughout the time that have made it to different championships. Women and men, I implore you to go look that up because it's quite fascinating. Real Madrid did it in the 50s. They're doing it now. It's not something that happens very often. You see it happen in the 50s. Actually, it seems like somebody at least once a decade rips off this 3 championship run in football. I almost said it again, y'all. I'm trying to change it. I'm trying to fix myself. Trying to see if there's anybody who did it in the 80s. We have the 50s, the 60s, the 70s. We have a couple teams that did it in the 90s. Nobody achieved it in football in the 80s, which is interesting. Wonder what happened there. Maybe. Oh, no, here we go. We have it in the... across different competitions. So in three different competitions, Juventus was able to accomplish it in the 80s, 83, 84, and 85. They won the European Cup, Cup Winners' Cup, European Cup. So if you count the different championships, there was one in the 80s for men's soccer. Women's soccer has it too. Lyon did it 2016 through 2018 and 2010 through 2013. Ume 2002 through 2004. I know I'm probably saying these teams' names wrong, and I apologize. Get at me on the text line and let me know how to say the name, 720-515-5597. If I'm getting it right, don't say anything. But, I mean, interesting, Zinedine Zidane, this guy that I know for headbutting in the World Cup for France, has turned into what seems to be a really good coach, seems to know the game really well, and is able to get guys to play for him and in the right position. It'll be interesting to see what comes out as to why he's leaving Real Madrid and what he goes on to do next. Because maybe he wants to be a GM. Maybe he's got aspirations to play again or to own a team. Who knows? We'll have to see. Interesting story. You generally don't see teams winning championships and things like that happen within the next week. But you also have stories of negative reasons why guys might have to leave teams or should leave teams or will be leaving teams, or negative reasons why people start talking about why guys should leave teams that may or may not be true. Kind of like this story coming out of Philadelphia right now with the 76ers. You look at the story with Brian Colangelo reportedly using multiple burner accounts on Twitter so he could talk trash to his players and about other executives and basically break the NBA's personal conduct policy, I'm sure, about speaking out on players and other teams and other high-ranking officials. If this turns out to be true, I don't see any other avenue that the 76ers really have in today's climate, in today's day and age, than to go ahead and let Brian Colangelo go. Now, maybe it turns out that this is true, and his motivations were to just that, motivate his players, tick them off, try and prove whoever this guy is who's bad-mouthing me online wrong, and show him out, right? Maybe he just thought he'd get away with it. And if I use this, you know, other name, nobody will know it's me. But going after your top players like Embiid, the rookie this year, Fultz, who had a really bad rookie year, going after other GMs and other players and players that aren't on the team anymore, but you went after them while they were on the team, like Jahlil Okafor. It's a bad look. It's not what sponsors and I guess a lot of fans want to see right now. When I first heard the story, my honest reaction, everybody, I mean, real talk, was, okay, so? I mean, okay. So he talked trash on Twitter. What? Unless he's not willing to go say the same stuff to the player or have the discussion with the player or the person about it, I was trying to find the problem. The more thought I put into it, the more I realized, okay, that's just not how you run a team. That's not trust. That's not sportsmanlike. That's not teammate. That's not camaraderie. And sure, Colangelo's not playing with him, but everybody in that building has to be on the same page for it to run smooth. From the owners down through the players, down through the towel boy, the Gatorade guy, the strength and conditioning coach. Everybody's got to be on that same page to run at an optimal level to get the ultimate goal of winning that championship. That, with a combination of the right players, the right guys, the right breaks, So it's just not a good look. You go through trust the process. Well, is the process creeping? Is the process being astray? Being sneaky? Like, do we reevaluate now what the process is? And to his credit, Joel Embiid has said, look, he reached out to me personally. He called me on the phone. He said this was not him. I'm going to take his word on it unless otherwise proved. They're running an internal investigation. The NBA is looking into the matter. Hey, the guy who broke the story got good information. He would not have put this out there and risked his livelihood if he didn't have good information. There's something there, whether we realize it or not. So this one is going to be also a very interesting to see how it is moving forward. All right, on a lighter note, let's go ahead and finish the story up with something lighter. We went through the drama. We went through the playoffs. We got a couple minutes left. This post went around on Twitter today. It was, what's your favorite team in each sport? Copy, paste, edit, go. NBA, favorite player for me growing up was Shaq. Loved the way he came into the game in the early 80s. Or, I mean, the early 90s, excuse me. I was kind of a Lakers guy, a Detroit Pistons guy before that. But Shaq was really the first player that I jumped on. NFL for me as a kid, Barry Sanders and Simon Fletcher. Grew up in Denver. Barry Sanders was a coach of mine at a football camp I went to. NCAA football, I put Rudy. That was the earliest, the first guy that I was like, okay, that was a fan of the show. I've thought about it more throughout the day. And two guys that I really liked as a kid growing up in Colorado were Eric Bieniemy and Alfred Williams. They were both studs for the University of Colorado. NCAA basketball, I went with Rick Hamilton and Maya Moore. Major League Baseball, Ricky Henderson and King Griffey Jr. NHL, Adam Foote, Wayne Gretzky. Boxing, I was a huge Tyson guy for a long time until he bit Evander's ear. Based on his ability in the ring, not on his personal choices outside of it. Let me preface. And then professional wrestling, not sports entertainment wrestling, not amateur wrestling. I went with The Ultimate Warrior. Those are my favorites. Go find the post yourself. Put your favorites out there. We'll talk about them. Hit us up on the text line, 720-515-5597. Check out the website, realdealsportstalkwithkp.com, Idaho Phoenix, Marcus Ogden, The Barbarians, the real estate Dr. Chad Nash, Vance Johnson, to everybody else out there. Until next time, you know how we do. Just be real.
Let's get it on. Time to hit that mindless flow. Mommy said she trying to roll. I told that bitch to find the dough. I ain't got no time for these bitches. I'm on my grind for dough. Rock a couple shows for mo. Weed liquor, designer clothes. Not to mention my fits accentuated with shining glow. I can sense the hate from the gate when I stepped inside the dough. Straight to the bar we go. Line a few shots up in the row. Knock them back and slam the glass as hard as dominoes. We ain't even dancing, just standing on couches lighting dro. Fuck security and the club owner already know. Bitches mesmerized by the hazy eyes and the wavy flow. Niggas hating harder than Satan, waiting to pull their chrome. But I ain't near shaking, I stand as broad like a solid stone. Antagonizing niggas by waving the double shot of Trone. This that ignorant shit you like to hear on a song. It ain't gotta be real when the fakest shit is getting on. Yeah.